Dearly beloved brethren, the scripture moveth us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, and that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with an humble, lowly, penitent, and obedient heart, to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the same by his infinite goodness and mercy. And although we ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before God, yet ought we most chiefly so to do when we assemble and meet together to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at his hands, to set forth his most worthy praise, to hear his most holy word, and to ask those things which are requisite and necessary, as well for the body as the soul. Wherefore, I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with a pure heart and humble voice unto the throne of the heavenly grace, saying after me, Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done, and there is no health in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare thou them, O God, which confess their faults. Restore thou them that are penitent, according to thy promises declared unto mankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, and hath given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardoneth and absolveth all them that truly repent and unfeignedly believe his holy gospel. Wherefore, let us beseech him to grant us true repentance, his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him, which we do at this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
God make speed to save us. The first lesson is written in the second chapter of the book of Genesis, beginning at the fourth verse. In the day that the Lord God made the heaven, the earth and the heavens, and every plant of the field before it was in the earth, and every herb of the field before it grew, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was not a man to till the ground. But there went up a mist from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And man became a living soul. And the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden. And there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. And the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And a river went out of Eden to water the garden. And from thence it was parted and became into four heads. The name of the first is Pison, that it is which compasseth the whole land of Havilah, where there is gold. And the gold of that land is good. There is bdellium and the onyx stone. And the name of the second river is Gihon, the same it is that compasseth the whole land of Ethiopia. And the name of the third river is Hiddekel, that is it which goeth towards the east of Assyria, and the fourth river is Euphrates. And the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it. For in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. And the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him an helpmeet for him. And out of the ground the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air and brought them unto Adam to see what he would call them. And whatsoever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof. And Adam gave names to all cattle, to the fowl of the air, and to every beast of the field. But for Adam, there was not found an helpmeet for him. And the Lord caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept. And he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. And the rib, which the Lord God had taken from man, made he a woman and brought her unto the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. And they were both naked, the man and his wife, and were not ashamed. Here ends the first lesson.
Oh. The second lesson is taken from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 8, beginning to read at the 22nd verse. Now it came to pass on a certain day that he went into a ship with his disciples, and he said unto them, Let us go over unto the other side of the lake. And they launched forth. But as they sailed, he fell asleep. And there came down a storm of wind on the lake, and they were filled with water and were in jeopardy. And they came to him and awoke him, saying, Master, Master, we perish. Then he arose and rebuked the wind and the raging of the water. And they ceased, and there was a calm. And he said unto them, Where is your faith? And they, being afraid, wondered, saying one to another, What manner of man is this? For he commandeth even the winds and the water, and they obey him. And they arrived at the county of the Gadarenes, which is over against Galilee. And when he went forth to land, there met him out of the city a certain man, which had devils long time, and wear no clothes, neither abode in any house, but in the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell down before him, and with a loud voice said, What have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of God Most High? I beseech thee, torment me not. For he had commanded the unclean spirit to come out of the man, for oftentimes it had caught him, and he was kept bound with chains and in fetters, and he brake the bands and was driven of the devil into the wilderness. And Jesus asked him, saying, What is thy name? And he said, Legion, because many devils were entered into him. And they besought him that he would not command them to go out into the deep. And there was there a herd of many swine feeding on the mountain. And they besought him that he would suffer them to enter into them. And he suffered them. Then went the devils out of the man and entered into the swine, and the herd ran violently down a steep place into the lake and were choked. When they that fed them saw what was done, they fled and went and told it to the city and in the country. Then they went out to see what was done, and came to Jesus and found the man out of whom the devils were departed, sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. Here ends the second lesson.
Thank you. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen.
Thank you.
Welcome to Trinity Chapel for this service of Choral Evensong. If you're here in the chapel, please do stay for a drink with us and introduce yourself to me, to John, and to our preacher, who is the Reverend Canon Robert Mackley. He's the vicar of Little St. Mary's, and it's lovely to have him with us. It's the church with the best churchyard in Cambridge. In fact, it's something like a miniature version of the Garden of Eden that we heard about in our first reading, except it doesn't have four giant rivers in it, and of course there's no serpent, as far as I know. He also owns the two best-behaved dogs in Cambridge, and I'm hoping that my new puppy will emulate his Labradors. But before we hear his thoughts on Christ's promise that we shall have life in abundance, we listen to our anthem, which is music by John Rutter, setting words by Lancelot Andrews.
Thank you. words from our first lesson. The Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Are you living your best life? It's a marvelous phrase, that hashtag, living my best life. I always smile when I see it. But are you? Well, singing Palestrina's canticles, fate voices, that's pretty best, if you ask me. Being here in Trinity College, Cambridge, there's quite a lot of best in that too, isn't there? So perhaps you are. But the question is, how do you know? Are you missing out? For living your best life suggests that there are a variety of lives available to you, and you just need to pick one. Like going into a clothes shop and seeing a variety of outfits on the hangers and choosing which one you like most, the most Instagrammable perhaps. And you take it off the peg, put it on, and off you go. Your best life, oven ready to live. Except, of course, there are a few problems with that idea. The first is the idea that me and my life can be separated like that, but I can just choose my life as if it's something other than me, which I can then control and fashion for myself. And yet a moment's thought tells us that can't be true. I can never separate myself from myself or step away and be objective about me, because what steps away is me. It's not, of course, that there aren't choices we can make. There are lots. It's just that I can't be apart from them, and that lots of them have already been made, some of them before I was born. Which brings us to the second and related problem, which is I can't just do whatever I want. There was a song doing the rounds a few years ago, I don't know if it's still popular, called Believe, by someone named Lynn Marsh. The chorus of the song went like this. I can do anything at all. I can climb the highest mountain. I can feel the ocean calling wild and free. I can be anything I want, with this hope to drive me onward, if I can just believe in me. Now I know what you're thinking. Who needs hymn to the creator of light when you've got Lynn Marsh's profound metaphysical lyrics? Just wait till you hear the tune. John Rutter, he'd never have got out of bed. But it's no joke. It's what you're told. Just believe in yourself and anything is possible. Now we're often told this for all sorts of well-meaning reasons, to encourage and inspire us. And if it's about working hard, then I'm sure it's a good thing. This is Lent term after all. Speaking for myself, however, I think it's fair to say that no matter how much I believe in myself, I will never be a professional footballer, a ballet dancer, a jet pilot, or a professional singer. I've got two left feet. I'm not a massive fan of heights, and I can't hold a note terribly well. I'm afraid I can't be anything I want if I just believe in me. It's a bit of a lie. But it's a powerful lie, a popular lie, and the lie so often behind the idea of living my best life, that I have an infinite number of choices, and I just need to pick one and then believe. But one of the reasons why anxiety, depression, and mental health troubles are off the scale these days is precisely because of this. Because we are demanding far, far too much from people. We're telling people they must completely invent their whole lives and identities. It's cloaked in the language of choice and freedom. It's made to look like a wonderful progressive thing. But it isn't. In practice, it's a crushing burden. It's a crushing burden because where on earth do we start? I've only got one life, and I need to do all these millions of things to make sure I'm not missing out. I'm exhausted just thinking about the idea, never mind doing it. It's a crushing burden because it fundamentally misunderstands what it means to be human and asks of us self-knowledge and a capacity to do and transform ourselves that we simply don't possess. It's a crushing burden because it's hard enough work just living, never mind worrying about whether I'm living the right option. Now, my dad recalls being at school and going to see the careers teacher. You told him what you liked doing and what O levels you were studying, and then, regardless of what you just told him, he told you you should go and work for Pilkington Glass. It wasn't a particularly good school, the children weren't especially bright, and the teacher saw his main task as simply finding them some form of gainful employment. It is possible he was also sponsored by Pilkington Glass. So yes, it's fair to say that in the past we have perhaps veered too much the other way. There were no choices. You followed your dad, usually your dad, into a career, and you kept in your social and economic class. This was not good. And if Lynn Marsh and Believe and living your best life is a reaction to all that, then frankly it's quite understandable. But it's still wrong. Wrong and damaging. And the Christian faith says something rather different. For a start, as our reading from the book of Genesis tonight reminds us, it tells us that we are created. We do not have to create ourselves. What a relief that is. It means I'm not totally responsible for my life. It also means I'm not totally responsible for all my failures. My life is a gift to me, which in many ways comes with plenty of choices already made. Not just that I won't be playing in the Premiership, but also all sorts of other character traits, strengths and weaknesses that guide what I might do and how I might live. Genesis tells us that the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground. God has been using the green and environmental movements of recent decades to teach us that afresh, that we are animals, created from the earth. While we have stewardship of the earth, responsibility for it, hence our reading speaking of our naming all the creatures, we are not set far above it, soaring away, able to do whatever we want at will. There are constraints, and our refusal to recognize them, in our trashing of the planet, or indifference to the value of human life, have terrible consequences that we see all around us in the world. We need to have some humility, a word that comes from humus, meaning ground or earth. We need to be earthed. The Lord God, our first reading told us, took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. In other words, he's given us a job to do. He's given us a vocation, a calling. We don't need to make it all up ourselves. And because it comes from God, our Creator, following it will make us happy. Now, we might imagine that vocations are things that belong to doctors and teachers and maybe even priests, and so they do. But in fact, we all have a vocation from God. In fact, we all have several vocations. The first is the most important, the vocation to be. You are willed, you are loved, you are necessary. You are loved and wanted just as you are. God will not love you any more with a first or £1 billion or a career as a human rights lawyer. He will not love you any more than he does right now. You can relax. The worst you can hold against yourself, the worst you think you know about yourself, God already knows and knows better than you. And still, he loves and likes you. As Genesis puts it, you are naked and you need not be ashamed. And our other vocations come from this one and are about what we do with this gift of our lives, about finding and opening what we might call our sealed orders from God. And God has already given us some hints and guidance in our natural talents and gifts, in accepting who we are and where we find ourselves. Ask yourself what you enjoy, what you're good at, what gives you peace and joy, and then you won't be very far away from finding your vocation. For to live our best life is to live the life God has given us. Yes, that'll involve plenty of choices and decisions, lots of them. But our true freedom, our true happiness, is to find the vocation already hidden in our hearts. Not to have to make it up anxiously by ourselves, not knowing whether we're right and what we're missing out on. For it is paradoxically in accepting that we are creatures that we are most free, and so truly we'll find life in abundance.